New Hampshire has spoken. Our First in the Nation primary numbers are in, and today on the Scene Review, we'll discuss the results and what it means for the remaining candidates and their respective parties. Then, the heroin epidemic. I think we can all agree we're dealing with an unprecedented drug crisis in America, as well as right here at home. We'll take a look at what's behind that and what we can do to help. And TV spectacles. The Super Bowl, the Grammys, political debates, award shows, 'tis the season for big TV pageantry. We'll get our panel's take on why we hate and love all the silver screen blitz. Hi, I'm Bill Humphries, filling in for Barbara Franzoso. Stay tuned for this and all more right here on the Scene Review. Our panel. Ruth Mott, executive coach from Coast to Coast. John Lyons, attorney and Republican Party activist. Eddie Edwards, one-time state Senate candidate, former police chief and chief enforcement officer to the New Hampshire Liquor Commission. And of course, our very own Renee Plummer, civic and political leader and head developer of PPMtv International Trade Book. Welcome back, everybody. Seems like we've survived the New Hampshire primary season once again.
Did we?
What happened?
Who knows? What we do know is that we don't know.
Because we don't know what, and what is it precisely that we don't know?
We don't know anything. I mean, a year ago, I said to you that I thought that Bernie Sanders would win the Democratic primary by double digits over Hillary Clinton, and that Donald Trump was going to win, lap the field and win the Republican presidential nomination. You'd think I was out back smoking a little wacky tobacco.
Yeah.
No, I think people would have said, who's Bernie Sanders?
Well, yeah, that was true. Who was Bernie? I, being a Democrat, really didn't know. Who is this guy?
See?
Yeah, he kind of popped up from nowhere.
Yeah, he did. But he excited those kids. Last time, you know, we took a poll of us guys, well, how many would vote, come out to vote, and it was a record turnout, which all of you had predicted.
Yeah.
I didn't. But to have that excitement again in the young people, I think is worth whatever it takes. This year I'm going to go on record here. I don't think Bernie is a president. I think that he's that he informs the debate, and I think it's important, the things that he talks about. I think that has to be part of the platform, or at least part of the program for the Democratic, if the Democratic president is elected. And that was a shocker. Trump was not a shocker. Remember, we talked about it. We knew Trump was going to win. Why?
That doesn't keep Trump from being a shocker, though.
Well, there's nothing about him that's shocking. Because you expect it.
Do you really?
From that
a lot of the things that he says?
I expect it from him, yeah.
I
do.
Okay. I think one of the things was really interesting, the number of people who were awakened. And I say awakened because these are people who traditionally are not involved in politics, they don't follow politics. You see some of the interviews that were going on. These were people from a gentleman who was giving tattoos, free tattoos of Donald Trump, put on their bodies. And a number of people were signing up. Bernie Sanders is the same way. So you have people who are starting to pay attention to politics because they have folks who are saying what they feel in their hearts and their minds. Not, I'm not saying they're right, but that's what they feel.
I saw a gentleman interviewed on CNN who was an independent, and he actually said, I'm having a hard time deciding whether I'm going to vote for Bernie Sanders or Donald Trump.
Oh, come on.
Oh, yes. Yes, I've heard
really?
The same thing from people.
It's just this, I'm not going to take it anymore. And people see Bernie and Trump.
Right.
As a Democratic woman, I was shocked by the number. More women voted for Bernie Sanders in New Hampshire than Hillary Clinton.
Yeah. You're not any more shocked than I was, to be perfectly honest.
Do you know anybody? Do you have female friends that voted for Bernie?
Yes, I do.
And are you shocked?
Absolutely shocked. And I asked, I said, how can you have a clear conscience doing that? Because this would be the first woman president.
Okay, but wait a minute. You're doing the wrong thing also by saying it's the first woman president, so let's vote for her.
Yeah.
Okay, but no, you're doing the same exact thing, Ruthie.
But the thing is,
just a minute.
It's a given that she is, in my view, qualified. So that's
we'll get to it later. It's almost the same thing as the people that are complaining about the Academy Awards.
What?
And the fact that you can't, that such diversity is not existing in the Academy Awards. Now, so how can you possibly, I mean, they're all jumping on now because it's not me. If they're all jumping on now because it's not a female.
What?
I'm surprised.
Yeah, I understand the point you're making. The fact of the matter is, if we want to become closer as a community, as a country, we can't identify people by the gender and the ethnicity. So people are guilty if you say, I'm not voting for you because you're a female, I'm voting for you because you're a female. I'm voting against you because you're black. I'm voting for you because you're black or Hispanic or white. That's the type of, that's what divides us as a nation.
Right, so that's not what I'm saying.
Well, it sounds like that's what you're saying.
That's what it sounds exactly like.
Listen more carefully.
All right.
But
try this again. Right. I'm shocked that you said that.
Okay, here's the thing. As a given, I think that she would make a very good president. Male, female, dog, cat. She would make a really good president.
Okay.
That's a given for me.
Okay.
The fact that she also is a female running for the president of this country is an added, what is it, an additional?
Nothing.
No, an additional
what?
Thing.
Reason,
thank you, to vote for her. Because I think a woman ought to be running this country. And but it has to be a qualified woman, and she is qualified.
Has to be the right woman.
It has to be the right candidate.
But she is the right candidate.
What about Madeleine Albright, who said that there's a special place in hell for women that don't vote for her? How can you square that?
I can't. I really can't. That was an abominable statement.
Well, I don't think she was thinking, which is really incredible that Madeleine Albright wasn't thinking of what she said.
That was not.
I mean, I couldn't really go after her, but it was a stupid statement.
It was a very stupid statement.
Also, it's something she says all the time. Like, yeah, I guess that's some people report that's what she says all the time.
That's your mantra.
I don't approve of it. Here's the thing. If we want a better country, we have to elect better people.
Yeah, good people.
If you think Hillary Clinton's ethics are not in question, then you should vote for her. I find her ethics in question.
Right.
Now, whether
like what?
Benghazi, her emails.
Wait a minute. Benghazi, she was cleared of any wrongdoing about Benghazi.
That's the difference between right and wrong and what's the legal and illegal. And so what we've done into our country is we started making the truth subjective. Right and wrong has become an opinion. And so we have nothing in common anymore. So we're willing to elect people who we know up front have questions about their integrity. So we think, no, that's okay. And we respect a better government when we're putting people in office who already have questions around their integrity. That's wrong. Whether they're female, whether they're black, whether they're white, whether they're Hispanic, is wrong.
Here's the thing. Being the president of a country like ours, you have to have thick skin, you have to be able to stand up to people like Putin and Assad and people like you have to go toe-to-toe with those people and not flinch. And Hillary Clinton can do that. I don't think Bernie can because I don't think he has the experience. But that he would be very good domestic policy. Foreign policy, Adam. So I think that is why I think Hillary would be really good because she can go toe-to-toe with anybody.
Would it be very good to have somebody you're voting for that is a self-described democratic socialist who is promising to give things away that has no ability to pay for it?
I know, I'm saying, that's why Hillary's my candidate. I love Bernie, I love his ideals, But they're ideal, they're idealistic, they're not realistic. So I get it.
So I have to
ask. That's why I support Hillary.
I have to ask you. If Carly Fiorina had become the Republican nominee.
No.
Okay. Why you want a woman for president?
I want a qualified woman for president. Yes, I do. Don't you?
I want a qualified candidate.
Well, I want a qualified woman to be president. As long as she's qualified.
And a Democrat.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
But Carly Fiorina, no way.
Can we go back to the election, though, and the number of people that voted? Because I like to go ahead and turn these lemons into lemonade. So, yes, I mean, now we have four people of the Republican Party that you would have never thought are up there in the polls.
Oh, no. Yes.
Scary. But the exciting thing is that the people that came out to vote for the first time.
Right.
I mean, they're part of the process.
That's what I'm saying.
And this is exciting.
Yeah, I agree.
Now, I don't know what happens January 21st of 2017. Whoever is in there, I mean, what happens to us? What happens if it's Bernie versus Donald Trump?
And what about the integrity of our party? What are you, your candidate was Ben Carson. You've had Cruz and Iowa claiming immediately before the vote that Carson was withdrawing, which is a blatant lie.
Right.
And this is why I have supported Dr. Ben Carson from the very beginning, because I think he has challenges like all of us do in terms of being perfect. None of us are perfect. But the thing he has that I think is necessary in our country is integrity. You cannot pull people who have different views or different opinions together if you don't have integrity. Because without that, if I know your candidate, Hillary Clinton, has challenges with her ethics, I am not going to believe anything she says. However, if I think that I disagree with you, but I think you're honest, I can trust some of the things you're doing because I think you're an honest person. And Dr. Carson has that. I think Ted Cruz revealed himself. I think he revealed himself. That's why I think those, I have a lot of friends who support Ted Cruz. And I think if you support someone like that, oh yes. Yeah, I have friends all over the board. I have a Democratic friend. So, okay, I have one. So, but
not here.
Right. But I think if you were to support Ted Cruz, you have to ask yourself, what do you stand for? I genuinely believe that if you support someone who's revealed themselves to be less than honest, and you think that's okay, then that's the person you want to see in the White House. That's the person you want to see governing us. That's the person you're betting your hopes on, bringing us together. Whether your positions in life are advanced or not, we need someone who's going to bring our country together. We're divided right now very intensely around race and gender, poverty, wealth. Everything that you could possibly think of, we're divided. Why? Because we have people who are leading us, and we're taking what they're giving us. We're just taking it.
Can I just, and you know what, when Ben Carson, and yes, you were right about him, the doctor with integrity, he has it, but when he kept on complaining about it, I thought, oh my goodness, all right, Ben, that was yesterday, okay? It's politics. Stop whining about it. Go on to the next thing. He kept on bringing it up to the point where he looked ridiculous. Because it's like, does this really bother you that much? Get over it. All right?
I don't think he looks presidential. It's a presidential look.
Again, to bring this back to New Hampshire, you ask what's going to happen, Bill. There were a few truths in New Hampshire. And one of those truths was the power of the Manchester Union leader.
Oh, yeah.
And in this election, that truth was balled up and thrown away. The candidate, your candidate, that they supported and endorsed withdrew after the Manchester election. And Donald Trump took the newspaper when they said bad things and threw it into the crowd and claimed that it was a rag sheet and he ended up winning. That is earth-shaking.
Well, it's terrifying is what it is, because he could end up being the president. Now, do we all move to Canada? I mean, what do we do when he's the president?
Well, you have to look at the vice president. Back then, the vice presidential candidates become very important. If it's Trump and it's Bernie Sanders, because
advisors.
Bernie doesn't look too healthy either.
No,
I mean, he's 75 years old. He doesn't look good, okay? I mean, he doesn't have that healthy look about him.
I agree.
People are already asking, tell me about his lifeline. Tell me about, you know, his parents and everything. So the vice presidential candidates are going to be the ones that we are going to have to look at. Careful.
Why in the world should we be looking at vice presidential candidates and we're looking at presidential candidates? I mean, that's like saying, you know, here's a diamond, but I've got a ruby that's got more carrots to it, so I'm going to take that. And I mean,
it may be our only choice.
Well, let me
just throw this one out. When John McCain was running for president, and he brought Sarah Palin into office, the thing that I was heard going around was that Sarah Palin was the best thing that ever happened to the Democrats.
Sure. Yeah. Yes.
Are we in a similar situation here that Donald Trump is the best thing that's ever happened to the Democrats in this particular race? Is his verbosity, is his overspoken presentations, is that working for him, working against him? Here's what I think.
If he is actually Donald Trump, right?
Yeah.
If he really is the Republican candidate, right? All of the people, to Eddie's point, all of the people who are fed up, right? He could well be president. He could well win it because those people would come out, I think, in droves.
Yes.
To vote for him.
I think to underestimate the possibility that Donald Trump might be the next president is to miss what's happening in the United States.
Right. I agree.
Right.
Absolutely.
Remember,
right.
Network, I'm mad as hell, I won't take it anymore. This is exactly what's happening.
I hope not. And you talk about John McCain, as to Eddie's point, John McCain was running against a black Democratic candidate. I think they searched for a woman to counteract. They were looking for a stereotype, and it absolutely backfired. It was a stupid miscalculation from a political standpoint. I was a delegate for the convention. I had a first row seat when Sarah Palin came out and gave her speech, and everybody got up and jumped up and down and applauded, and it was an absolute mistake.
Oh, dear. It must have felt terrible. Particularly
because
you can see Russia from her house.
you know, if you think about this, right? One of the things I think our party started with the Republican Party is that we have to pick, they have a black, then we have to find a black. We did that with Michael Steele. That they have a woman, then we have to find a woman.
Right.
They have an Hispanic, we have to find a Hispanic. I think that is what's dividing us. You cannot lead people. Now, I've been in the military, I've been in law enforcement. You lead people regardless of their ethnicity, where they come from, their educational levels. You have to bring them together. And if you have a candidate who cannot do that, we're in trouble. And whether you like it or not, Donald Trump seems to be the candidate who's bringing people together from all sorts of different places. Their different educational backgrounds, women,
I agree.
Minorities,
working people,
one thing he's saying that resonates with the average person out there, I'm sick of it. I'm sick of losing. I'm sick of my government abusing me. I'm sick of hearing what wealthy people think. I'm sick of hearing what politicians think. I feel this way. I feel like I'm being squeezed out of my own country, and I'm sick of it. And that resonates with blacks, Hispanics, whites, women, everyone.
That's true. That's what I'm saying. If he is the Republican candidate, I don't know whether we put up Hillary or Sophia Loren. It won't matter.
Sophia Loren.
Yeah.
You're reaching back.
Yeah, yeah. That book, we got to get the same page.
Of the Republicans that are on the
table.
Well, he's viewing me out. Would you vote for Donald Trump? If Donald Trump became our nominee, I would vote for Donald Trump, particularly over Hillary Clinton, Bernie Sanders, absolutely.
John? Lindsey Graham was asked that question.
And he said?
And he said, I might oversleep.
Should not vote?
This brings us back to record numbers of people who are voting.
Look, if Bernie Sanders is the candidate, there isn't and the candidate that is the one that I have the most opposition to is Ted Cruz for a whole variety of reasons. A lot of it goes to what Eddie was saying. But if it was Bernie was the candidate, the old saying, the problem with socialism, you eventually run out of other people's money. I think he'd drive his country to a place in which would be worse off than we are now. So I don't know what I would do.
That's the Lord is yes, you vote for Donald Trump.
I was trying to read. Thank you, Eddie.
Yes.
Ooh, there was
that's
a shiver.
I would not, let's put it this way, I would not vote for Ted Cruz. So, yes to Donald Trump, but not to Ted Cruz. I have to say that.
So, what would you vote for?
Would you vote for Hillary?
Yeah.
Would you?
Yeah.
Would you jump ship?
Yeah. And I have to tell you, I know a lot of Republicans that do the same thing if it was Hillary versus Ted Cruz.
Oh, God. All right. Yeah. I hope you hear from guys don't put up Ted Cruz. Is. He is evil. He really is. But wait a minute. Because Bernie Sanders can't just go in and do what he thinks he can do. There is Congress. And he would have to, I mean, before he could bankrupt the country, he would have to go through a few legislative bodies to have some program.
Since I quoted Lindsey Graham once, I'll quote him again. You know, Bernie Sanders and his wife, literally for their honeymoon, went to Russia. And Lindsey Graham says, and they never came back.
Is there somebody that you would choose to write in? You could write in.
Well, that's a possibility. I can't imagine myself not voting.
Good, right.
I also have difficulty with the fact that we as Republicans tend to eat our own. The Democrats, no matter who their nominee is, whether it's somebody they support or not in the spectrum, will always come out and vote Democrat. As Republicans, if it's not the far right wing or the moderate person, we tend not to vote, and I believe we've handed a lot of elections to Democrats. So I will go out of my way to be able to try to support whoever the Republican candidate is. Hopefully it's somebody that I'll be able to do that with. At the end of the day, as this shakes out, I still have to believe that it's going to be a Kasich or a Bush or someone else that will be the Republican nominee, and that it will be Hillary on the Democratic side, and we'll have an election of ideas between people who are qualified to become the next president.
So we're only one caucus and one primary election into this whole year-long show here. Is there an opportunity for somebody else to rise to the top?
I think so.
Do you mean like an independent party, like a Michael Bloomberg, who could be coming in?
Somebody other than Trump.
I don't know. You know what's interesting, though, about the Republican Party? You have three of the candidates there that all speak Spanish, which is just amazing.
Right.
You know, Rubio, Cruz, and Bush. Right. They all speak Spanish. It's I wanted to hear more. I wish they continued speaking Spanish, because it's not only us that are listening.
Oh, that's right.
You know, and watching this.
That's why I thought Marco Rubio would run away with it, because he has the Cuban vote, certainly. And I think he has a lot of the black vote as well, because people like it.
I'm not sure either, maybe. I'm not sure it's the black vote.
Because you thought the country was divided.
I absolutely think it's divided.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Rubio has a little of the Obama hangover. What I mean by it is this. I believe, and there are a lot of Republicans believe, that Obama, as a first-time senator, did not have the chops to become the next president. He didn't have the experience to become the next president of the United States. And that some of the issues we face are as a result of that. Rubio is a first-time United States senator. Senators talk. It's what they do with debate. Whereas a governor leads, makes decisions, has to step up in a crisis. And there are a lot of Republicans that were looking for a governor, but now we have a businessman. So we'll have to see what happens.
Well, I happen to agree that a governor is better prepared for being the president than a first-time senator. I'm not going to go into an argument with you about Obama, but I do agree with that theory. So you had Christie, who was a governor, not in it anymore. And I think Kasich, I think if it were between, no, I can't say that, I'll still vote Democratic, but I think Kasich.
Of course, Kasich, you will.
Yeah, but I think Kasich is a worthy opponent. I do, more even than Jeb Bush.
Well, I had a conversation with Renee, and I think of all of the Republican candidates, the one that suffered the most from Donald Trump was Chris Christie because of this. Chris Christie has this brash New Jersey, New York, I'm going to tell it like it is. And Donald Trump took that space, and Christie could never catch up.
Yeah. Right.
So he wasn't able to distinguish himself from the other candidates.
That is a very good point, actually.
Let me just ask Renee real quick, because you endorsed Chris Christie.
I did.
Going in. How has that affected you now that he's dropped out? And does that have any bearing on your endorsement power or pedigree underneath the...
No. I mean, I don't think so
at all. Where would you go next for your endorsement?
I think governors. You know, it was, for me, it was between Bush and Christie. So it would, I don't know, I really don't. I loved Governor Bush because you get to know these people. And you have to, it's like Hillary Clinton. You can't think of her connected with Bill Clinton. You can't think of Jeb Bush connected with George Bush or his father. You have to take the person and to see what they did. And what he did in Florida was incredible. So I would go back and it would be Bush, that would be my, and then after that, I do not know. Because what it's looking like is Trump, Rubio, Cruz.
Let's I'll tell you though, I think Trump coming in has made this election season almost entertainment. I don't mind watching the debates. I don't mind getting the ads. I don't mind any of it because he's just such a character.
Well, the characters are bound in political arenas regardless of,
you think?
of what the election happens to be. And there's a lot of stake for both parties in this election cycle, and everyone's fighting tooth and nail for the biggest piece of the pie. And the game changed very unexpectedly this past weekend. Once again, here's our own Ruth Mott with her perspective on news of the day.
This past week, the country learned the sad news of the sudden passing of Supreme Court Justice Antonin Scalia. He was 79 years old. Just 2 hours after his death, the Republican Party announced that they would not pass any nominees that the president submitted to the Senate as his replacement, regardless of who they are or what their qualifications might be. With 54 seats in the Senate, they have the power to do this. That same night, another Republican presidential debate was held in South Carolina. Not even 24 hours after Justice Scalia's death, the candidates on that stage were already talking about the importance of obstructing President Obama's nomination. In fact, the first topic was the subject of the debate's opening questions. Each of the candidates made it clear that they felt that the president's successor, whoever that may be, should be the one to appoint a new justice to the Supreme Court. Donald Trump even went so far as to suggest the tactic, and I quote, delay, delay, delay. What happened to the respect for the power of the presidency last Saturday night? If these men were the staunch defenders of the Constitution that they would like us to believe they are, they would support the current sitting president's constitutional responsibility to fill Justice Scalia's vacancy. The Senate has never taken more than 125 days to vote on and confirm a Supreme Court nominee. The average time it takes to do that is 25 days. As of the taping of this program, President Obama has 337 days left in his term. This is plenty of time for him to name Scalia's successor, despite the fact that the opponents say that 11 months is not a large enough window. It would be unprecedented for the Supreme Court to go almost a full year with a vacant seat. So here's my question. Since they can't guarantee that there will be a Republican president, why does the GOP want to potentially cripple the Supreme Court and create a major disservice to the country? Can you answer?
I am absolutely against this. I don't know why the Republican Party is doing this. They look so foolish. You know, you have to put yourself in there, in Obama's seat. If we had a Republican president, he would say the same thing. Stop it. Somebody has to stop. I know that you're going to be saying, well, you know, with President Bush, there was a delay. With President Clinton, there was a delay. Somebody has to stop this and think about the country. And do you know who Obama is going to put in? I mean, they were talking about it a couple of days ago. And whoever this judge was from the appellate court, he seemed to be reasonable. So let him go ahead and throw some names in. What are we doing?
Well,
there's other things in this world that are more important right now. So let's go ahead, see what he has instead of fighting this, and you know, bring it to the congressional or the Senate committee hearing, and see what we have to work with.
Isn't it a rather blatant way of saying, let's wait until the Republicans get into office and then we'll choose our own guy? I mean, aren't we gambling with the country in that regard?
They shouldn't be doing this. What do you
think? Well, yes, and there are several Republican sitting presidents who nominated people to the Supreme
Court.
But Ruthie,
I don't even want you to go to Republican versus Democrat, because it's been happening. But I would hope that the Republicans would just stop this and say, okay, Mr. President, give us a list of your names.
Right. I agree. John, you look like you're ready to say
something. Oh, he's ready to
jump. Well, I've a couple things. First observation that I would have, which was, I think, an example to everyone. Do you know who were best friends? Anton Scalia and Ruth Bader Ginsburg.
That's right, yes.
And they are as far apart politically, but they were colleagues and they made each other better. And Renee is right. Theoretically.
Can you say that again?
Renee was right, theoretically.
Okay.
When somebody asks a question and you go back. When you were a kid, if you got in trouble and your mother said you shouldn't have done that and you said Susie Q did it, she'd say, if Susie Q jumped off the roof,
would you? Right.
However, there is a significant hypocrisy for Barack Obama to complain about what the Republicans did. Because he tried to filibuster George Bush's nomination in the last year of his term for the same exact, you can read the speech. What the Republicans are saying now is exactly what Barack Obama said. He was unsuccessful.
Right.
It's extremely hypocritical for him to say otherwise now.
So what? I mean, what he did say was he's going to do his job until January 21st, 2017, and he expects the Senate to do the same. Do your job.
What if the Senate feels that their job is to properly vet? Now, look, I think it was absolutely, maybe this is the reason people like Donald Trump. I think that if you were a businessman negotiating a deal, would you have said ahead of time what the Republicans have now said, that we're going to delay? You keep your mouth shut, and then you delay. You don't need to telegraph it.
Right.
And that also allows you the ability to look, as Renee has said, to determine who the nominee is. Maybe it would be somebody that everybody could support. But now you've put yourself in such a bind, everybody, including me, thinks the way this was handled was inappropriate.
Well, look what happened with Associate Justice Kennedy.
Right.
I mean, they thought that he was going to be conservative.
Right.
Yep, and then he surprised everybody.
Right. Souter from New Hampshire, too, turned out to be
that's
Souter.
Right.
Yes,
that's true. So
let's
you have to go for the qualifications. The thing is, if the longest period of time to appoint and confirm a justice was 125 days, do they really think that 337 days isn't enough time?
You could do it three times over.
We could nominate, three vacancies, We might.
Well, we're in the midst of this crisis, but we're also in the midst of another massive cultural crisis. Heroin use and overdoses are at an unprecedented high across the country, but especially here in New Hampshire and Maine. And it seems like we're reading about these tragic events on a weekly basis more and more. In 2015, heroin-related deaths outnumbered highway fatalities in the state of New Hampshire. State police say that 13% of all traffic stops that led to blood and urine testing involved this drug. It has affected us all in one way or another, regardless of age and social status. So, panel, where do you even begin to talk about this particular issue, Eddie?
I think when it comes to heroin use, we have to go back upstream and realize that 90% of heroin users now are white young individuals, age 23. 75% of them or more started with opiate use. In the late 80s, doctors, pharmaceutical companies, advertised, promoted directly to doctors. They started now promoting their drugs directly to the customer, the consumer. That consumer now goes into the doctor's office and says, this is what I want, this is what I wanted to try. Pharmaceutical companies also are giving doctors' offices promotional items to try on patients. So it's not surprising that some of the pharmaceutical drugs are much more powerful than even some of the illicit drugs.
So in the 60s, everybody talked about marijuana as being the gateway drug. You smoked a joint, you were immediately going to become a heroin addict. Has that changed in your perspective now? Is the gateway drug prescription? Is it coming from physicians?
Well, I think this is what we do with our drug policy of prevention, right? We constantly look to figure out how do we address this. In 2014, the state of New Hampshire, Governor Hassan declared a state of emergency on synthetic marijuana because kids in Manchester and Concord were overdosing. We passed synthetic legislation, marijuana, synthetic drug legislation. 2015, we faced a heroin issue. In 2016, 17, 18, there will be other drugs that come up because we do not have an effective prevention program in place. We've reduced our prevention programs to a poster in a school or the DARE program or some one-off program that's not sustainable. You know, if you look at prescription drugs, whether you're talking about being prescribed by a doctor or over-the-counter medication or you're talking about illicit drugs, you're talking about a system where people are trying to self-medicate for whatever reason. When people are depressed, they drink. When people are happy, they turn to drugs. No matter what's going on, because that's the culture we've created. We created that for our young people, so we shouldn't be surprised that this is the result of that. When you put profit over patients, you should be surprised by these results.
Well, I am surprised by the results, by how many and how young, and people now dying, young people dying as a result of overdose, whether they're intentional or, you know, by mistake. I do want to take 1 minute, though, to say something to Renee, to say thank you to Renee and Dan, her husband, for the starting the endowment to the Farnham House in Manchester. Yes. I mean, that kind of thing gets a lot of publicity. So that can be elaborated on and can be used as advertising and as promotion and as pushing the dangers of drugs. The thing is, everybody knows the danger of drugs for the most part, but they don't pay attention.
The danger of drugs as it applies to an individual who's overdosing.
Right.
What's the danger of drugs as it applies to the community as a whole?
Well, it sort of tears the fabric of our community.
Right.
Two things I have to say. The gateway drug is still marijuana. And it's not the marijuana of the 60s or 70s. Because what these drug dealers have done is they now take the regular marijuana and they have put in this fentanyl. They have put in something that it's strong for them. Okay, so you already are addicted, and these kids don't understand that the marijuana that they might smoke is not just a marijuana cigarette. It's laced with fentanyl where they're gonna be looking for more. The pain doctors, yeah, clinics that are out here, these people should be hung. They are just sitting there and they're just writing prescriptions 60, 70, 80 people, patients a day, they come in and they're just giving them the prescriptions. So what happens when they say, well, we can't give you any more prescriptions? Well, then they go ahead and find the heroin because everybody knows it's $5 a bag or $10 a
it's
bag
cheap.
Versus $30 or $40 for a pill.
Right.
And people don't understand what pain is anymore. Nobody right. needs to have pain. Everybody wants to be happy. Well, that's not the way life is.
Right.
All right? You have to have a little pain to understand. I mean, some of these people should be spanked.
Well, I agree because they're not
talk about
only
pain.
Have a little extra pain.
About a little extra pain.
With a paddle.
Yes, yeah. Absolutely.
Or maybe a stick, like what's the football player who did that to his kid? Can't remember.
Adrian Peterson.
Yeah, he's the one. Anyhow, but seriously, the pain clinics are not only giving prescriptions for one opioid, they're combining them. Take this in the morning, and then in the afternoon, if you still have it, take two of these. And then, I mean, it's just horrible. It's unconscionable, I think.
I'd like to ask, though, Renee and Eddie, let's assume everything you say is correct. Those causes would be across the country. Why, and you would think that it would be worse in an urban environment, why in little old New Hampshire and Maine is it more acute?
Okay. So my theory is, we know and we're hearing more about it because the world was just here for the primary. They lived here for 8-10 months. Mm-hmm. I think they were looking for more things, okay? And I don't want New Hampshire to be related to the heroin crisis. So I had to think about this. I thought, well, wait a minute. You know, you have New York, you have Ohio, I know. I mean, and then you realize all the other states are having the same problem, except all of the world media was just here. How much can you talk about Donald Trump or Martin O'Malley or Lindsey Graham? So I think that they needed new stories. This is my thought, and I'm hoping that I'm right.
It's a good thought.
And so if you went to every other part of the country, I think you would find the same use. It's just that we had everybody on TV, radio, and print talking about what was going on.
I would agree with that as well, but I'll also add, too, that drug use in urban areas has always been less than people realize. It's always been that way, but we think drug use is higher in urban areas, largely because you have blacks and Latinos live there. Honestly, that's what it comes down to.
Could you stop doing that with the blacks and Latinos?
But that's a fact. That's a fact. When people look at drug use, our drug policies really in this country are what?
I think you're being racist.
I am.
I didn't say it this time.
But a lot of our drug policy has been shaped around that issue, just like crack cocaine versus cocaine. Same substance, you get different sentences depending upon which one you use. This issue of opiate use started in pharmaceutical prescriptions. The largest percentage of first-time heroin users now are white young people.
Yeah.
And I think that's why there's a huge push in this country to change our drug policies. A huge push. But you have to also think about the number of young blacks and Latinos who are languishing in prison for the same drug policies that were there before. So I think for a lot of people around the country, when you start seeing this, you think to yourself like, okay, we're gonna shift now to prevention and treatment, where before we kind of looked at it like, hey, you use, you go to jail, you go to prison. That's a real issue.
So what do we do with it?
Well, this is one of the reasons why I was on board with Christie, Governor Christie, with what he did. Instead of these people, and these drug courts, they're all over New Jersey, we need to have them here in New Hampshire.
Agreed.
So what he did was, you're caught and you're going to be arrested, you're not going to go to jail. You're going to go do something for a year in one of the, I think he took former hospitals that he now turned into these clinics. So where it was, you know, I'm going to say $40,000 for a prisoner or for somebody to go to jail for a year, it was $26,000 or $27,000 for them to go in for 1 year and to sit there and to learn about this. I mean, it was brilliant. It was absolutely brilliant to be able to do that. I also want people to realize it, and you're right, Eddie, it's not the poor people on the other side of the tracks. I mean, I have a niece who's a heroin addict. she lost her child. I mean, the boyfriend has a child. She hasn't seen Addison in 5 years. The story, the sadness, and it's the first time you use it, and I think it's called chasing the high or chasing something, that they have said that the first time they do this is such a euphoric feeling, but they never get it back. So they try it again and again and again. And it's just so sad. And since I became very public about this, there are more people that have come to me, people that we all know, that have the same thing in their family, but they don't want to say anything.
Of course.
And it's sad.
And that's why voices like Renee and Dan's voices are so important to our state, because of your leadership role in the state. So when you step out and you lead on an issue like that, it actually opens the door, creates a platform for people to feel comfortable coming forward.
And to say something.
Right.
Yeah.
So, again, that you should be commended.
Yes,
and
absolutely.
Dan as well.
Oh, believe me, I wish we didn't have to do this. I mean, I'm sort of excited about the time when we start closing these Farnham centers.
Right.
I mean, Farnham now is going to open up one in Franklin. They have the Webster Place, and it opens up March 4th. I think there's going to be 22 or 23 beds. Seven of them are going to be dedicated to veterans. We need them. Unfortunately, New Hampshire doesn't have anything like this.
It's an ongoing problem. And we want to just let everybody out there know that if you have someone that you know that's seeking help, we'll provide some links at the end of our program for you to check out. Moving right along, do you watch the Super Bowl for the plays on the field or for the plays of the commercials? What about the Oscars? Do you really care who wins best sound mixing, or are you just dying to see the dresses? And admit it, a part of us have all been watching the presidential debates just to see who walks away with the most egg-covered face. Well, we are infatuated with all this big, glossy, glimmery television events, but it always hasn't been that way. Panel, what's your take on this? What do you hate about the spectacles? What do you love about the spectacles? It's all show business, but there's...
Well, it depends on the spectacle.
Right.
I do watch the Super Bowl because I'm an avid football fan. And I do also rate the commercials, but I wouldn't care if the commercials were terrible or not there at all. It's the game. I like the Super Bowl. And I do like all the hoopla around it. I like the halftime show, and someday I want to produce a halftime show. So I love that part. As for the Oscars, I mean, I am a film buff, so I do kind of care about what they do. I do like to see the dresses. But the awards, the Grammys, the Oscars, the
Tonys,
the Foreign Press Awards, there is no other occupation I know of that salutes itself in such a grand way. They just keep giving themselves awards all over the place for the work that they do. So I don't like that part, but I do like the Super Bowl. And now with Donald Trump, I am watching all the debates because that's also a kind of spectacle. That's my take.
It also gives you, it takes you away from your everyday work, the grinding, everything that you do, to turn on something like that and to just be relaxed. And be entertained. It's absolute entertainment, and you have to keep it in your head. Going, they are entertaining us. They're the greatest marketers in the world.
Oh yeah! Oh my gosh! Yeah.
You know.
It's a subsidiary of entertainment. I mean, the motion picture industry is there for the purpose of entertainment and escapism. But all of a sudden, this, like you say, these pageantries that go on and on and on. Everybody says, "Oh, I'm great! I'm so great!" And they're clapping each other on
right.
their own backs.
Right. And thank you for nominating me among these wonderful other people.
It's another form of entertainment, is that
well,
right?
It is.
Yeah.
I spent a couple of winters, actually, in Mexico. And the Academy Awards were on television, but everything was in Spanish. So I couldn't understand a single word. But a single word I could understand, but I couldn't understand the patter of it. So I watched, and it was so much nicer to watch it because I didn't understand anything. I could just watch what was going on. I could watch what
and
was going on.
Did you get the storyline?
Oh yeah, of course. But it didn't matter. Do you know what I mean? I could just tune it out. The same was with football, because the announcers were in Spanish. I could just watch the game. I could just tune out all of the chatter.
I am a huge football fan.
Yeah.
But I couldn't bring myself to watch the Super Bowl because the Patriots.
Right.
And instead, I watched on ESPN, they have a program called 30 for 30.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
And the program I watched, it was about the South African rugby team that Nelson Mandela used to bring the country together.
Right.
And they interviewed these avowed racist Afrikaners who he just changed.
Right.
You saw them at the beginning and you saw them at the end. So I didn't watch the Super Bowl because I was pouting and I saw something that was an amazing program that made a difference to me. The rest of the stuff I don't really care
about.
And
don't forget, we only are going to love the Grammys and all these awards when Senior View gets an award.
Absolutely.
That's right.
So there you go. And then we will all be
like, watch.
Oh my God, you were so great. You were so great.
The Emmys are not that far away.
Yeah, I know. Well, the Grammys were already.
The Boston Regional Emmys.
The Emmys. Yeah, you've won an Emmy.
Yeah.
Yes, he's won a couple of Emmys.
Yeah.
Great job.
Keep going.
Yes. He won an Emmy for a wonderful program that he allowed me to be an AP on, which was on the New Hampshire juvenile justice system. And it was excellent, and he won an Emmy for that.
Yeah, it was a long time ago.
So nice to be sitting next to you.
They make great doorstops.
Oh, my gosh.
Keep your basement door open.
Yes,
so
with your...
With the wind, yeah. Well, here at the Senior View, we are always brainstorming topics, and we feel are of interest to you. So tune in next time to see what's on our minds, but we'd really love to hear from you, our viewers, about topics of importance from your perspective. So join the conversation, and if you have a story idea, a comment, or an issue you'd like us to cover, discuss, or banter about, please drop us a note or an email to info@ppmtvnh.org or through good old-fashioned snail mail to The Senior View, care of PPMtv, 280 Marcy Street, Portsmouth, New Hampshire, 03801. We'd love to hear from you and make your voice a part of this particular show. So we've come to that point, gang. We need a few final thoughts about what we've talked about today, where we're headed, what's up, and John, you want to start?
I just like talking about stuff with all of you. You know, if anything, I hope that we would be an example to people watching, that you can disagree and talk about stuff, and it makes us all better. I thoroughly enjoy this opportunity and being part of this panel, Bill.
Excellent. Ruth?
What he said.
What he
said. Really?
Enough out of you.
All right.
Shocker.
Renee, any final thoughts on this particular?
Well, if we could talk about politics, that we know that we know nothing about politics. So just there it is.
Okay, Eddie.
Well, you know, I echo what everything's been said here. I've got wonderful friends here where we can disagree in a very robust way and still smile about it. And I'm very thankful that we have this type of leadership in our state, though. I think what Ruth said earlier about Renee and Dan, I think it's very important. You can't miss that in our state where we have regular citizens, business people, willing to take a stand and do what's right. And that's something we all should be proud of. And that's why we have this show to kind of push that out there. So.
Thanks to all of you. I really appreciate it. And thank you for your patience with me. I sitting in here for the first time on this particular show. It's been a ball, and I really appreciate your kindness. Yes. As always, my many thanks to Ruth Mott, John Lyons, Renee Plummer, and, of course, to Eddie Edwards. And from all of us here at PPMtv, The Senior View, and our sister program, So Much for Seniors, thank you for tuning in. Join us again next time as we continue to discuss issues from The Senior View. I'm Barbara Franzoso, filling in for Bill Hunt. Strike, cut that, reverse it. With apologies, Willy Wonka, I appreciate it. Thank you very much. We'll see you next time.
That's definitely going to be on the bloopers.